good YouTube land, it's your boy Jerome. I'm back today with the review for Love and Banana Season 7, Episode 4, titled Do It For Finesse. So, without further ado, let's get into this video. So we start this episode out with the shooter. You know, all the guys are meeting up after his, you know, his son's death. Shooter lets us know that his son was shot over $35, and the dude that shot him in the neck, and he shot him 4 times. Like, that's really trivial, and it's really sad that a young man had to lose his life over something so stupid, so juvenile, and so petty that, you know, all of that could have been easily avoided. You know, they could have squashed whatever it was, and that young man could still be living today. But instead, you know, you had to use gun violence to settle something that could, you know, even if you were to fight, that's something that you could have settled with your fist. It just doesn't make a lot of sense just to kill somebody over something so senseless. Like, that's something that, the person that killed his son, that's something that he can never take back, and that is something that he has to live with for the rest of his life. And I pray for him, and I pray for Shooter's family to, you know, have the peace to move forward with their lives. Like, that's got to be so hard for Shooter. And I, you know, despite everything that Shooter did last season with Mariah and all that stuff, I really do feel bad for the guy. And they're also talking about, you know, the younger generation, how, you know, they want to try to, you know, put something together so that they can talk to the younger generation about the things that they see in the movies, in the videos, and all that stuff. And, you know, that was a really good scene, and I really kind of, you know, like that, you know, how Kirk and all of them were talking about how they grew up in the streets, and, you know, they were praying that they can live to see 18, and, you know, today's kids that are younger than I am, you know, I see, actually back in my hometown, I see a lot of people that just die at young ages, you know, because of stupid, petty gun violence that could be easily avoided, you know, and it's really sad to just see someone in their, you know, early 20s, or even late 20s, dying because of, you know, a situation that just could have been easily avoided. And then Shooter also informs us that he's, you know, Sierra hadn't been around since the whole funeral situation. And my thing with that is, you know, I can see Shooter's side and I can see Sierra's side. You know, I can see that Shooter just, you know, he lost his son, he buried his son, and he wants his wife there to be by his side. But, Shooter, you gotta look at it from Sierra's point of view, too. Like, you did her wrong last season. I get that you expect her to be there, but I think that, you know, you have to allow her to have time to herself because, you know, she was still mad at you. But, you know, like I said, you buried the child, so she was there for that. But you can't expect her to be there every waking moment with you. Like, she still has, you know, to live with that stuff that you did with Mariah last season, so you kind of have to put that on the back burner and be like, you know, I wronged this woman. So I just can't expect her to be there completely. And then we also get another scene where Jock invites Shooter out to a community service event that newcomer Bachi, I think that was a dude's name. You know, and I think Jock said that he was a club promoter. I mean, not a club promoter, but I think Jock said he was a promoter. Well, might be a club promoter. I don't remember what Jock was saying about that dude because I really, too honestly, wasn't paying attention about him. But I do know that, you know, Bachi and his girlfriend Keely are in Atlanta. She just moved down to Atlanta from New York. And, you know, she and Shooter are good friends. And then, you know, she asks Shooter about the whole Sierra, what's going on between him and Sierra. And he tells her what's going on between him and Sierra. And then, you know, she kind of inserts herself in it. And I'm like, Keely, this ain't got nothing to do with you, boo. Stay out of it. And then she's talking about how she want to hook him up with one of her friends and stuff like that. And I'm like, this has nothing to do with you. That's between him and his wife. And you might just want to stay your ass out of it. I think that might be who Sierra hit with that person in the trailer. But so far, you know, with Keely, I don't think I'm going to too much be feeling her like that. Because, I mean, I get that you saying Shooter's your brother and your friend and all that kind of shit. But his marriage ain't got shit to do with you. So you should stay your ass out of his marriage and worry about your man over there. So next we get Tommy meeting up with her mama Sam. And, you know, Tommy's whole thing is that she just wants to apologize to Sam for the whole situation that happened with Tommy and Versace when they first got together to try to, you know, hash out their differences, and when Tommy and, you know, Versace got into with each other, and Tommy threw the ice cream cone at Versace's head. And Sam's thing is, you know, she just wants her daughters to be able to sit in the room with each other and not fight with each other and just, you know, have a civil conversation with each other. And Tommy kind of agrees to that. And then, you know, when Tommy agreed to that, Sam brought up that she wants them to do a family portrait with each other. And, you know, Tommy's thing is she's not going to do a family portrait with them until she gets an apology from Versace. I'm thinking she wants that apology from Versace because of Versace or whoever called the police on Tommy and got more charges on Tommy. So, you know, I don't think Tommy's going to get that apology from Versace. You know, she may get that apology from Versace, but Tommy is such a hothead that she's going to want to fight the girl every time she sees her. If she's not drunk, if she's sober, I think Tommy might be open to listen to it. But if Tommy's drunk, that bitch ain't listening to shit. So Sam has a bright idea of, let's do this family portrait. I don't know who the fuck told Sam to do that family portrait. And have Tommy come there with Versace there to apologize. Like, Sam had to know that shit was going to go left. And then Tommy came in there drunk on top of that. Like, so they're in there taking photos in 70s style clothes. And them wigs look fucking horrible. Like, Mona, that shit was cheap as fuck. That was ugly. So, like I said, you know, they're doing the family portrait. And then Tommy walks in. And, you know, immediately Tommy felt ambushed by the whole situation when she saw Versace there. But Versace did come up to Tommy and try to apologize to Tommy. But Tommy just went left on Versace and caught her. Man, they were calling each other all kind of bitches and hoes and stuff like that. I'm like, y'all got to be the most fucked up family I ever saw in my life. That y'all can have a conversation without trying to, one, fight each other, two, calling each other bitches and hoes. So, you know, once Tommy and Versace stop arguing with each other, then Tommy flips and goes off on Sam. And then her and Sam start calling each other bitches and hoes. I'm like, damn. And then, you know, those people in the, you know, people have taken photos of them, looking at them like, what the fuck do we sign up for? These people are crazy. And then, you know, actually, we ended the episode with Tommy meeting up with Scrap's baby mama. I think her name was Tierra. And that's how we ended this episode, with Tommy meeting up with Tierra. And then next week, we'll see how that situation goes with those. So next, Kirk. Oh, I'm so hopeful for Kirk. I'm shit. So he meets up with Jasmine. So his whole thing was, you know, after, you know, Shooter bearing his son, it made him want to spend more time with little baby Cannon. So him and Hoseman meet up at the lawyer's office, and, you know, he's meeting with her, and, you know, he's trying to, you know, figure out, you know, one, why did she go to Rashida's store? And her thing was, she went to Rashida's store because, you know, she wanted to apologize to Rashida. And, you know, she wants Cannon to get to know his brothers and sisters, which there's nothing wrong with, you know, you want your child to meet his siblings. Absolutely nothing wrong with that. But your approach is absolutely bad and wrong. You are going to Rashida's store, Kirk's wife, who you knew was his wife. Like, that's the shit that's bad, my nigga. That's the shit that's bad. Don't go to this woman's store, place of business, looking for her. You have no business with her. You have no dealings with her. Your dealings is with Kirk, the father of your child. Leave Rashida out of it. Like, Rashida has to come around in Rashida's time, and Rashida actually doesn't have to come around ever. You know, Rashida can, you know, let her kids have a relationship with little baby Cannon, but Rashida ain't got to have a relationship with him at all. Like, that's your child and Kirk's child, not Rashida's child. So for you to keep coming around trying to, you know, talk to Rashida and have conversations with Rashida and apologize to Rashida. If I was Rashida, I'd tell you it's a little bit too little, too late. Like, you knew that they were married when you slept with him. And then, you know, she, you know, Kirk was talking about how he doesn't want his son around any kind of, you know, bad environment. Particularly that threesome that they had, that threesome trio relationship that she had last season with her, Kiana, and what was his name? Rod. Or as Forrest Ross calls him, Thing Ving, I think that's what she says. But yeah, and then, you know, Jasmine lets us know that, you know, she's no longer with Rod or Kiana because in a relationship, there was no trust. Like, no shit, Sherlock. Y'all, it's three people in a one relationship, and there shouldn't be any trust. You and Kiana both slept with Kirk while Rob was in prison. And you got pregnant while Kirk, he was in prison. So, of course, Sherlock, there's no fucking trust there. Ding dong, dumbass. And then one other thing Kirk is talking about, you know, when he found out that he was the father of Cannon, you know, he did child support so that Jasmine and little baby Cannon are taken care of, which that's all fine, my nigga. That's fine that you, you know, give to them financially. But he needs a lot more than just financial stability from you. He needs to be around his father to get, you know, get that father-son time. And, you know, Kurt just gets on my fucking nerves. Actually, him and Rashida and this Jasmine girl, Hoseman girl, they all get on my fucking nerves. Like, I'm over this. I'm really over this storyline. Can we please move the hell along, Mona? Please. Please. So then Kirk meets up with Rashida. And when he meets up with Rashida, you know, he was just telling her about, you know, him meeting up with Jasmine and the conversation that they had, you know, about. And she was like, well, what was the conversation about? And he was basically like, you know, about her coming to press. And then Rashida's thing was like, well, why does she come to press? And, you know, stuff like that. And then Kirk just let her know that the reason why she comes to press is because she wants to apologize to Rashida. And then two, she, you know, she wants the kids to have a relationship with each other. And Rashida's thing is she's not going to keep her kids away from, you know, Cannon. Basically, what Rashida's saying is she's going to leave it up to her kids if they want to have a relationship with their brother or not. And, you know, as far as Rashida goes with her relationship, you know, having a relationship with Cannon, she's saying it's going to take time if she ever wants to have a relationship with Cannon. And again, Rashida doesn't have to have a relationship with Cannon because Cannon is not Rashida's child. Yes, she is married to Kirk, but Rashida does not have to have a relationship with that child at all. If I was Rashida, man, I would never have a relationship with that child. I mean, that's just me being me. I wouldn't want to see that child. I wouldn't want to have anything to do with the child, but Rashida and I are two different people. And then while they're sitting down at the table, Kirk lets Rashida know that he's brokered a new deal for her with her workout stuff. So I'm assuming he was talking about like maybe workout DVDs and stuff like that. And then Rashida says, see, this is what I'm talking about. You don't tell me anything. You need to, you know, I want you to start being more honest with me. And then, you know, out of nowhere, he's talking about, well, you know, with the business of can he come back to the house? I'm like, nigga, nah, you can't come back to the house. You still got a baby by Jasmine. Like, get the fuck out of here. Go stay with her or stay where you're staying at now. Like, just because you broke the deal for her does not mean you can come back to the crib. Get the fuck out of here, Kirk, with that shit. All right, next. So next we get Sean Garrett and Messy Red. Mona. How much you paying Sean Garrett to be Carly Red's newest piece of dick? Really? How much you paying that nigga? You must be paying him a good amount of money to play her love interest. So we get a scene where Sean Garrett is serenading Carly Red. And, you know, he and Carly are having a conversation. And then Carly has to let us know, as she always knows, that the newest piece of dick in her life is better than the last season's pieces of dick that she had before. I'm just like, Carly, you gonna still be a bird that's gonna be your storyline each and every season. The newest nigga you can get. Right? You should be tired of that by now, right? Like, you went from Benzino to Jock, to Jeremiah, to Life Jennings, to Scrap, to Caesar, to back to Jock, and now Sean Garrett. Girl, your pussy should be retired by now. For real. But on to a more serious side with this scene, Sean Garrett lets us know that his mom passed away from cancer. I don't forget when he said his mom passed away. And then Carly brings up her dad, who she said had a heart attack. And, you know, after he had the heart attack, she found out that he had cancer. And, you know, Carly was telling us that, you know, her dad was never really in her life. So it's hard for her right now, you know, with him being sick and all. And, you know, she's been the one to have to take care of him and all that kind of stuff. It's just hard for for her, which, you know, in that situation, I do feel bad for Carly that, you know, her dad had a heart attack and he has cancer. Like, that's some serious, serious shit. And, you know, when she was talking to Sean, you know, Sean just let her know, hey, maybe you should get your dad and bring him to Atlanta and, you know, go from, you know, see what things go from there. And then we also find out that Carly has two other sisters who are both older than she is. They all have the same dad, but they all have different moms. I think maybe one of her sisters live there in Atlanta. And as she said, her other sister lives in New York. And the sister that lives there in Atlanta, her name is Katrina, I believe. And, you know, Katrina and her son come over to Carly's house. And Carly has brought her dad from Florida up to Atlanta with her. And then Carly lets her sister know that, you know, she got a letter in the mail that said that she was his power of attorney, and that she also got his last will and testament. You know, that's got to be like a hard thing to deal with, you know, a sick, well, I know it is, because I had my mom was sick when she passed, you know, before she passed away. She was very, very sick, and it's really hard and really stressful to deal with that kind of stuff. So my heart goes out to Carly, but, you know, at the same time when my heart went out to Carly, back to going back to Sean, you know, after, you know, huh, Sean talk about their, you know, parent issues, this bitch pulls out the bird move and hops up in the front of his face talking about what she ain't got on up on the hook, what that outfit she was wearing. I'm like, damn, Carly. One minute I'm sitting here feeling bad for your bird ass, and then the next minute I'm calling you a motherfucking bird again. Like, oh. But, you know, but in all seriousness, I really hope everything works out with Carly Rae and her father. So once the Bocce dude is through doing his promoting stuff and all that kind of stuff, he comes over there where Jack and Keely are, and he sits down, and then, you know, him and Keely start arguing about the girls over there in the VIP section. They gave him his number, and, you know, they just going back and forth and back and forth, and then, you know, she gets up and tries to throw the drink at him, but that drink completely missed his ass, and that shit was funny when that drink just missed him. And then she was talking about, well, you gotta, you know, figure out where you're gonna stay at tonight, because you ain't coming back to my place, and all that kind of stuff. And I'm just like, they already draining those two. So next we get this scene where we have Just Barney and Keely meet up at the nail shop, and they get their nails done. And, you know, Just Barney is talking about the whole situation that happened with her, Mena, and Escalators. And, you know, she's just talking about how she, you know, Rick Ross, you know, referred her to Stevie J, but she's not really sure that she wants to work with Stevie J because she's not, you know, here for the love of Stevie J and all that kind of stuff. And then she's still shading people, talking about she ain't, you know, she ain't slept with Stevie, and, you know, she ain't slept with Stevie or anybody to get where she is. But, you know, you don't have a lot of talent. So how did Rick Ross sign you again? And then what about Zero from down here in Houston? What happened with you and Zero? Yeah, you think people done forgotten about that shit, but I move on from that. So again, you know, she's talking about how, you know, Stevie J wanted her to sign a contract and all this kind of stuff. And Keely's talking about, you know, well, how about she comes in and be her, you know, what kind of man, a project manager for her. And, you know, Just Barney tells Keely that, you know, Stevie J has wants her to come to some kind of a mixer. And then, you know, Keely's like, well, how about I come with you, you know, so she can talk things over with Stevie and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, Just Barney's talking about doing music with Stevie. Like, listen to her last week, her singing wasn't that bad, but I've listened to Just Barney rap, and Just Barney is not a good rapper in my personal opinion. Like, I just can't deal with her rapping, but that little singing that she did, it wasn't, like, the best, but it wasn't the worst. But her rapping, I just can't with Just Barney and rapping. Just Barney should give up on rapping. She should give up on that and, you know, try to sing just a little bit. So that was Love & Hip Hop Atlanta Season 7, Episode 4. And I hope you guys will like the video. Leave your comments below. And I will see you guys later.